Hey guys, welcome to this channel that is Economics at a Glance. So yes, we are back again after so long period. So guys, as you know, we have completed the microeconomics completely. And many of you have requested for completing the agricultural production economics courses, as many of the competitive exam is upcoming. So this will be my try to let you know everything regarding agricultural production economics. Okay, so let's get started, guys. Today, we will study the introduction terms of agricultural production economics. So certain terms are there you should know before moving to every laws and problems of agricultural production economics. So today in this lecture, we will cover only the introductory part. Okay, let's get started then. See, first is definition. What is the definition of agricultural production economics? See, production economics, it is the application of the principle of microeconomics in production. Well, we have completed many things in microeconomics. So whichever you have studied in microeconomics, when you apply those principles in production, or let's say agricultural production, that thing will be agricultural production economics. Okay, so the application of microeconomics in production area, that will be agricultural production economics. Okay, so based on this theory of firm, these principles explain various cost concepts, output response to the inputs, and the use of input to maximize the profit and minimize the cost. Well, we have already completed the cost concept, different types of cost concept, how we can able to define them in graphical form. What are the formulas? Apart from that, we will study here like how our output respond to different inputs and how to use the inputs in very efficient manner. Those things we will cover. Okay, so production economics thus provide a framework for decision making at the level of a firm for increasing the efficiency and profits. Okay, got it? Okay, this is all about the definition. Next, we will see the objectives, why we should read agricultural production economics. First thing, to determine and outline the conditions that give the optimum use of capital, labor, land, and management resources. I have already told you there are four factors of production: land, labor, capital, and entrepreneur. So the first objective is how to use these four factors of production in an optimum way. Optimum means maximum profit, minimum loss. Okay, so how we will use them. Okay, this is the first objective. Second is to determine the extent to which the existing use of the resources, it deviates from the optimum use. We all know that what is the optimum rate of use. We can have the formula to get it. But now the existing use of resources, how we are using now, and now what we are using, how much it is deviating from the optimum use. That also we can determine so that we can change our existing things. Got it? Third thing is to analyze the forces which condition the existing production pattern and resource use. Which forces? It may be demand, it may be supply, it may be many things. So we will analyze every kind of forces. Next is to explain the means and methods in getting from the existing use to optimum use of resources. Same thing, from existing use to optimum use, but through which means and which methods. Okay, so these four are the major objectives of agricultural production economics. Okay, see, before moving to three stages of production, different relationship like factor-factor, product-product, first we need to know all the basic concepts that is related to agricultural production economics. Okay, see, first is production. What do we mean by production? See, the process through which some goods and services, which are called inputs, they are transformed into other goods called output or product. This is very basic. Like in a production system, why we are doing production? Because there is demand. Okay, so after getting demand information using the raw materials and parts and resources, we are producing the products. Okay, so all the inputs are transformed into product or output through the process that is called production. Okay, so this is the thing. Next is, see, production function. See, we have already completed production. So when you will express this production in the form of a mathematical equation or a mathematical expression, that we will call as a production function. Okay, suppose you will tell, I have used labor and capital for producing any kind of good. And that thing has been explained in this way. See, Y is equals to a function of K and L. K is your capital, L is your labor, Y is the output. So output is the function of capital and labor. How much we can calculate, okay? So in this form of expression is called production function, okay? So whenever you have seen a systematic and mathematical expression of the relationship among the various quantities of inputs or input services used in a production of a commodity and the corresponding quantities of output, that will be called production function. Always focus on the line systematic and mathematical expression. You will express your production process mathematically. Okay, this is called production function. Well, this production function is again two types. Either it will be continuous production function or discrete production function. What are these? See, this is the major difference between continuous production function and discontinuous, which we used to call discrete production function. Okay, see, the first point, in continuous production function, this function arises for those input which can be divided into smaller doses. That means you can divide into many small doses. Suppose 2, you can divide 1.5 and 0.5, 1.2 and 0.8. You can divide it into many smaller doses. Those are called continuous production function. But in case of discrete production function, what happens? This function arises for those inputs or work units which cannot be divided into smaller units, and hence they are used in whole numbers. It can be either 1 or 2 or 3. It cannot be 1.5, 1.2, 1.8. It cannot be. It can be only whole numbers. 1, 2, 3 or 4. Okay. See the second line. Continuous variable. They can be known from measurement like seeds and fertilizer. Suppose you are applying fertilizer. So fertilizer can be applied 1 kg or 1.5 kg or 1.8 kg. It can be divided into decimal doses. But see, in case of plowing, weeding, harvesting, can you tell 1.5 times plowing I have done? No. Okay, so plowing can be done at least once or twice. So it should be a whole number. So in this kind of thing, we will use discrete production function. In this case, is fertilizer seed, we will use continuous production function. Okay, always remember which can be divided, that will be continuous, which cannot be divided, that will be discrete. Okay. Next coming to production period. See, timing of the production, depending upon that, it will be short run or long run. We all know that the difference between short run and long run. See, the planning period during which one or more of the resources are fixed while others are variable resources. Those planning period is called production period, is called as short run production period. But what about long run? The planning period during which all the resources are variable resources. See what happens actually. Suppose short run. Short run means what? Maybe a 6 month or 8 month or hardly 1 year. Okay. So within 1 year or within 6 months, certain resources are there which cannot be changed, like land, building. Do you think within a year you will buy certain two or three land? No. Two or three building? No, it's not possible. So one or two things or one or two resources will be fixed and others will be variable. That is the short run production period. How we will write that? See, y is a function of x1, x2, a bar, x3 up to xn. So here, y is your output. X1, x2, which is before the bar, it is variable, and rest of all are fixed input. See it very carefully. Always remember the variable before the bar, they will be variable inputs and rest of things are fixed inputs. And same in the form of long run. See, long run means it may be 5 year, it may be 10 year. Okay, so in long run, anything can be changed. Land also you can purchase another, building also you can make another. So long run, every resources will be variable resources. So how we will write here? Y is a function of x1, x2 up to xn. So here x1, x2, xn, they all are variable inputs. So always remember, for exam, in long run, every resource is variable, but in short run, before the bar, the variables are, the resources are variable, and all the resources after the bar, it will be fixed inputs. Okay. Next. As we have discussed so many things about resources, let's see what are the resources. See, anything that aids in production, it will be a resource. So the resources physically enter the production process. We all know that, okay? So the resources are of two types. Either it will be a fixed resource or it will be a variable resource. See, the fixed resources, the resources that remain unchanged irrespective of the level of production, that is called fixed resources. Like I have told you, land and building, they cannot be changed with the level of production. Okay, they will be same irrespective of the level of production. But regarding variable resources, the resources that vary with the level of production, they are called variable resources. For example, in case of fixed resources, land, building, machinery, so these resources exist only in short run. Okay, I have told you, in short run, you cannot change land, you cannot change building. But in long run, what happens? In long run, the building, land, it can change. But in short run, it cannot be changed. So in case of variable resources, these resources exist both in short run and long run period. For example, seeds, fertilizer, chemicals. Okay, so they will exist both in short run and long run. So the cost associated with this kind of resources are fixed cost, and the cost associated with this kind of variable resources, it will be variable cost. So this is the major difference between fixed resources and variable resources. See, the land and building, these are the fixed resources because in short period of time, we cannot change it. And the variable resources, they are seeds, fertilizers, okay. Then coming to another two type of resources, flow resource and stock resource. It is also important. See, the resources that cannot be stored and should be used as in when they are available. If you will not use it that time, it may not be available at the rest of the time, like labor. If you are not hiring a labor now, maybe after 2 or 3 hours, it will be taken to another sector and you cannot find a labor. So whenever it is available, you should take it. Why? Because it is a flow resources. But stock resource means you can store it. And you can store it, you can use it sometime later also, like seeds, fertilizer, and the implements, we can store it. But depending upon the length of time of our use or of our consideration, it also got varied. Okay, these are flow resources and stock resources. Now coming to efficiency. See, efficiency is of three types. It may be technical efficiency or economic efficiency and allocative efficiency. See, what are they? First is technical efficiency. Technical efficiency, it is the ratio of the physical output to input. Simply, output to input. How much input you have used, how much output you have got. If you will take a ratio of that, you can get the technical efficiency value. So what it basically implies? It implies the using of resources as effectively as possible without any wastage. Okay, efficient, technical efficiency means how you are using the resources without any wastages, okay? And how you can find out output divided by input, okay? Next, coming to economic efficiency. See, it is the expression of technical efficiency in monetary terms through the prices. That means the monetary value of output divided by monetary value of input. That means simply, if you convert the technical efficiency in monetary terms, in money terms, it will be economic efficiency. Simple. See here, in other words, the ratio of the value of output, matlab monetary value, okay, what is the price of output? So value of output to value of input, it is termed as economic efficiency. So now what it will imply? It will imply the maximization of profit per unit of input. Per unit of input, how you are maximizing your profits, that is your economic efficiency. Now the third efficiency is allocative efficiency. See, it occurs when no possible reorganization of the resources can make any combination higher yielding without making other combination less yielding. Simply see, what is allocative efficiency? How you are allocating the resources among various sector, no other combination can be very sufficient, very, very efficient than you. If you are allocating very efficiently and compared to all others, then you are allocative efficient. Okay, so it refers to resource use efficiency. Your allocation method is the best method and is the efficient method among all the alternatives. Then you are allocatively efficient. Okay, so this is technical, economic, and allocative efficiency. Sorry. Yes, another two terms. See, cost of cultivation and cost of production. See, these two terms are like sounds very similar, but there is a very basic difference in which students got confused. What is that? See, whenever it is cost of cultivation, it means the expenditure incurred on all the input and output services in raising a crop on a unit area, okay? A unit area. That's why it is called cost of cultivation. As it's a unit of area, it is expressed as rupees per hectare or rupees per acre. But similarly, in contrary, cost of production, what happens? The expenditure incurred in producing a unit quantity of output, that is called cost of production. As we are focusing only output, it will be rupees per kg and rupees per quintal. Here rupees per hectare per acre. Here rupees per kg per quintal. Okay. So production means it will be per output unit. Cultivation means per area. This is the basic difference. Next, coming to independent variable versus dependent variable. This is very easy. Still, I'm covering here. So the variables whose value does not depend upon any other variable, rather it will influence the dependent variable, it is called independent variable, like land, labor, capital. If you are not using the land, then nothing happens to the land. But if you are not doing the production, production will be zero. But if you are not doing anything to the land, land will be as it is. So it is an independent variable. Okay. But dependent variable, see, the variable whose value depends on other variable. Your production will depend upon the land, labor, capital. Okay. Land, labor, capital is not depending upon the output. Okay. So your crop output, it's a dependent variable. Then there are certain terms which are to be used in the three stages of production, that is TPP, APP, and MPP. We will briefly introduce here. See, TPP stands for total physical product. Okay. So the total amount of output it obtained by using different units of inputs, that is measured in physical units, those are called total physical product. Or in short, we can say how much output is produced. That is called total physical product. And for example, it will be like shown in units, kg, tons, etc. Okay, then coming to average physical product, APP. Okay, how we can have APP output per unit of input on an average. Okay, here Y is your output, X is your input. Output divided by input, it will show you average physical product. Clear? Last one, that is marginal physical product, that is MPP. How we can have that? Addition to the total output obtained by using the marginal unit of input. Suppose you are changing the input use. So one unit of change in your input, how much change occurred in the output? That ratio is called MPP. Okay, suppose you are changing your input by one unit. So due to the change in one unit of input, how much change occurred in the output? That is called marginal physical product. And it will be expressed by change in Y divided by change in X. Okay. So this is the three stages of production, which we will cover in the next lecture. See, this is your TPP curve. This is your MPP curve, MP, and this is your APP curve. Okay, in details, we will study in the next lecture. This is the introductory one. And lastly, we will see what is the major difference between agricultural production economics and farm management. See, agricultural production economics, it deals with agriculture industry as a whole. Okay, but in farm management, it will deal only with the individual farm or industrial unit. But agriculture production economics, it will deal farm, it will deal industrial unit, it will deal with the aggregate one. That's why, as it is dealing with the aggregate one, it is under macroeconomics. I have covered what is micro, what is macroeconomics. Okay, so it will be under macroeconomics. And as farm management is dealing with individual farms, it will come under microeconomics. Okay, so this is a very important question. Agriculture production economics, it will be macro, and farm management, it will be micro. Okay, so as it is a macroeconomics, think in this way. Macro means an aggregate way. So it deals with inter-farm study between different farms. Okay, and farm management, it will deal with the intra-farm. In one farm, what happens? Okay, we will study in farm management. But between different farms, what is the relation? That will be covered by agricultural production economics. And that is why when we will talk about agricultural production economics, it will deal with allocative efficiency of resource use. But in farm management, it will deal with economic efficiency, because you are dealing with only one farm. So you can easily form like what is the monetary value of the output, what is the monetary value of input. So it will be easy for dealing with economic efficiency. But agriculture production economics, it will deal with the allocative efficiency. Okay, understood all of you? So thank you all. This is all about the introductory term of agricultural production economics. I hope all of you are getting very clearly. Still you have any doubt in the introductory part, you can freely comment in this comment box. I will there to be explain you. Okay, and next lecture onwards, we will start the three stages of production. Till then, stay with my channel and don't forget to like and subscribe my channel. Thank you.